Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
How do you do, my friend? Welcome to the Friday edition here at Bible Tract Echoes. Right now, my Bible is sitting open to the very final chapter here in the book of Leviticus. We have walked our way through the entire book, and today we complete our study of the book of Leviticus. And no, we did not do this verse by verse. Most of the chapters we took one chapter at a broadcast time, and we're going to do that today. So if you can, get your own copy of God's Word. Join me in Leviticus chapter 27 and get something with which you can jot some notes down. I will give an outline today, but also with that pen and paper handy, you'll be able to have our contact information when it is given. I want you to have that so you can give to us your name and mailing address, and I'll give you the reason for that here in just a moment. Well, let me lead into the broadcast in our study this way. Now, people under duress have been known to say all kinds of things and to make all kinds of promises. You know that. It's always been that way. Many a soldier in the heat of battle has promised God all kinds of things, even to become a preacher. When somebody's waiting on a serious surgery on that day, many a person in that situation has promised all kinds of things to God themselves. They're going to go to church every single Sunday, or even going to put money in the offering plate, and so on. Now, often these vows and promises go unpaid and unfulfilled once the good outcome has been achieved. The person doing the promising feels like, well, God just understands that they had made that promise in the heat of the moment, and he really doesn't expect them to follow through, really, does he? Well, in Leviticus 26, the chapter from yesterday, there are some warnings of harsh times on the nation of Israel if they were to leave God and start serving other gods. In those harsh times of chastening, the Jews would have readily promised God all kinds of things. Well, that brings us to chapter 27 today. That's what this chapter is all about, those promises. God holds people liable for those promises and vows that they make. The New Testament puts it this way, and I'm quoting now, "Every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account." Now, if you can, get your Bible open with me, Leviticus, please, chapter 27. I told you I wanted you to have a piece of paper so that you could get our contact information and then give to us your name and mailing address. And here's why. Bible Tract Echoes, the radio program, is the radio arm of a larger ministry called Bible Tracts Incorporated. And I want to give you a free sample packet that contains one each of all of our English gospel tracts. Now, a gospel tract is a short, written presentation of God's plan of salvation. It's an evangelism tool to help you share the gospel with lost people. I have one in my hand right now. It's entitled, "Do You Know For Sure? Do You Know For Sure?" Now, this tract, believe it or not, was written with a certain target audience in mind. It's written for people that have a great desire to use a priest, a human priest, to help them accomplish spiritual things before God. There are many different groups that use them. The man that worked with me to get this done happened to be a man who was a missionary to the Mormons for 50 years. This tract, while the word Mormon doesn't appear there, lays out the plan of salvation very, very clearly. But what else this tract does, it highlights two things. Number one, that Jesus Christ is God, the eternal creator God. But number two, that Jesus Christ is our high priest. Oh, not a high priest after the order of Aaron in the Old Testament, but after the order of Melchizedek. The Aaron priesthood is gone. It's no more value to us. We have a better high priest. That's laid out in the tract. It's very clear. If you have somebody you'd like to see come to Christ who feels that they just have to have a human priest, may I say that this is exactly the gospel tract that person needs. Do you know for sure? It's in that sample packet. Give us your name and mailing address. Be ready when my announcer gives our contact information, or you can just go to our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org. If your Bible's open to Leviticus 27, I begin at verse 1. It says this, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, When a man shall make a singular or special vow, the person shall be for the Lord by thy estimation." Jump over to verse 10. "He shall not alter it, nor change it, a good for a bad, or a bad for a good. He shall at all change the beast or of beast, then it and the exchange thereof shall be holy." Look at verse 14. "And when a man shall sanctify his house," look at verse 16. "And if a man shall sanctify unto the Lord some part of a field of his possession." Now, there's a lot here, but I'm going to stop reading right here at this moment in time. Now, if your Bible's open, look at the last verse of chapter 26. That verse says that chapter 26 gives us the last things God said to Moses when he was up on Mount Sinai. So the actual Mosaic law has already been completed. Now in chapter 27, we have God's direction for the people when they make a special promise or vow to God. Now, God did not require the people to make special vows. Often people today promise all kinds of things to God, but they do so, frankly, trying to bribe God. Before a serious surgery, we promise to go to church and so on. We think that God is hearing us because we're offering these things. Our motive, though, is to buy God's blessing. And I'm sure you realize that God, the God of heaven, can't be bought off. He owns the world, and he needs nothing. How do you bribe somebody like that? Well, as I said a couple of minutes ago, there in chapter 26, there are things that are stated about how God would chasten Israel if they stopped living and following Jehovah. There were some harsh and even worsening things that God said he would do. If in the midst of the chastening, the people made promises to God, well, then chapter 27 says that they needed to follow through with what they promised and tells them how to do it. Now, here's how chapter 27 unfolds. Four parts. Are you ready? In verses 1 through 8, we're told there what happens when you vow or promise a person to God. Then in verses 9 to 13, it tells us what happens when you promise or make a vow of an animal to God. Then in verses 14 to 29, where it tells what you do when you happen to vow a piece of property to God. And then the last verses, 30 to 34, tells us what happens if you want to keep part of your tithe. All the details are there. Now, that's what Leviticus chapter 27 is all about. By the way, do you remember the woman named Hannah in the Bible? Her story's over in 1 Samuel chapter 1, and there we find that she is promising to give to God her child if God would only allow her to have a child. Well, she had a baby boy. His name is Samuel, and at the proper time, she gave him to the high priest just like she promised. Now, if Hannah desired to keep Samuel with her and him to not live at the tabernacle, then the guidelines of Leviticus 27 would have applied to her. She would have to pay a redemption price to get her son out of the vow she made. For some promised items, like animals and property and so on, you'd have to not only pay the correct redemption price, but you'd also have to add to that 20% more. That all being said, I can almost hear some of you asking the question, "Brother Mark, so what? Why in the world do we in the 21st century need to know about this anyway?" Well, my friend, I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you three things. First of all, number one, making vows to God is not required, but it's a practical matter and a practical thing to do that you might be prompted to do by the Spirit of God. Vows are not wrong. They can be very godly when done out of a dedicated heart. Sometime go over to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. There we're told that the people of Macedonia, the believers there, gave special gifts to God. But first they gave themselves to God. That is the proper order in making a promise or a vow to God. Give yourself first, then make your gift. Second thing about why chapter 27 of Leviticus is important is this. God takes our promises, God takes our vows seriously. He takes us at our word. How many times have you and I chuckled at the promises made by politicians while they're running for office? Well, sadly, in our promises to God, many of us are just, frankly, we're just politicians. We're saying all kinds of things to get God's vote on what we want to do, get God's vote to make our life blessed, and so on. Friend, over in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, we're told there it's better not to vow a vow than to make a vow or make a promise and then not fulfill it. All right? One more thing. Why do you and I need to be reminded of what God takes seriously, the vows there in Leviticus 27? Here it is. Jesus said in Matthew 12 that every idle word. The word idle means careless. Every word spoken carelessly will be held up to us, and you and I will be judged upon what we said. Ecclesiastes 12 says that God will bring every word into judgment. Now, we need to stop and ponder that a moment, shouldn't we? It's better to just sometimes keep our mouth closed and say nothing at all than to let careless words come out because they're going to be judged by God. Now, all this sounds rather ominous, doesn't it? And frankly, it is. But if what you and I say will be judged by God, and we're going to be held accountable for it, then let me just remind you, the words spoken to us by God in the Bible are equally accountable. Beloved, do you hear what I'm saying to you? If God holds you and I accountable for every idle word, then what more can we, the weight can we put into God's word when he speaks to us? His words are not idle. They're not careless. They're pure words. They're spotless words. Their friend, every word of God is given by inspiration. They're breathed out of God. They come from the heart of God. You and I can trust God's word. You and I can believe what he says. When my God says to me, Mark, if you confess your sin, I am faithful, I am just to forgive your sin. I will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I can take God at his words. When God says, if you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I will save you, I will give you the gift of eternal life, I can take God at his word. When God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you, I can take God at his word. Beloved, our words matter to God. God's word needs to matter to us. We need to trust them. We need to live our lives by them. We need to utilize the power of the word of God to see other people who know not Christ as Savior come to him. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.